Want a G Wagon, huh? The G Class, the big body Benz, huh? You've seen them on the socials, you've heard about them in the songs, you just think they're the coolest. Well, I'm here to tell you, as a big body Benz owner, no, you don't want this thing. For 99% of people out there, this is objectively a terrible daily driver. But Dominic, if they're so bad, why does everyone want one? Allow me to explain. It actually goes back to before Mercedes even sold these in the US. It was a company named Europa that would import Eurospec versions of these. They were very rare and they were very expensive, so it was only people like athletes and actors that could afford the six-figure price tag for what was more a piece of farm equipment than a luxury SUV. Unfortunately, that status symbol status has snowballed and has followed them to this day. So now people in town either think I'm a professional soccer player or a dick. And I am not a soccer player. Unfortunately, I'm not kidding. This thing gets me a ton of bad attention. So let's go for a drive. But usually before I hop in, I like to throw on something a bit disorienting to ward off all the bad comments and just play the part of eccentric guy in an eccentric car. All right, let's go. Seriously though, this truck is hilarious when you get to know it, which doesn't take that long, it ain't that clever. And when you do, it becomes strange that it's come to carry the status that it does. It really is misrepresented. You see, the development of the Geländewagen, which means off-road vehicle, started in the 70s. The first design models were built out of wood, not clay, which, yeah, that tracks. It was originally developed with military use in mind, so body-on-frame construction, three lockers, and the aerodynamics of a barn. And it really didn't change all that much over the years. So what really happened is they took a utilitarian truck, purpose-built, and they tried to add some luxury to it, but as they say, you can take the boy out of the country, but you can't take the country out of the boy. And this boy's rocking a bolo tie at the black tie party. This is Garth Brooks in Friends in Low Places. You see, this car, at least the earlier US spec versions, is really a Mercedes parts bin special, plus parts retrofitted onto this ancient platform. Mine has a 5-liter V8, tried and true, but it's the same one that was used in the S500, among plenty of others in this era. It's stout, it's not stressed, and they've been known to last hundreds of thousands of miles. The center console is basically plucked from the entry-level Mercedes of the era, the C-Class, and it's horrific. Not only does it feel like buttons are going to pop off when you press them, buttons literally pop off when you press them. Touch points in here are an absolute joke. There's no satisfying click. You're touching what feels like hollowed Toys R Us plastic. The center stack, the door cards, the window switches, it's all bad. And it all adds to the rattle trap that this thing is. And you have parts that are unabashedly tacked on to the 1970s architecture, like the iconic basketball hoop cup holder, which, full disclosure, I love. The seating position is straight up tractor, super upright, but pretty comfy. But the best place to be is actually in the back seat. They sit up high like stadium seating, they're super cushy, and they have seat warmers. And speaking of sitting high up, you definitely have to hop into this thing, which gives you a cool commanding view of the road, especially with the greenhouse windows. But it's so tall that if you live in the city and have to go into parking garages like I do, good chance you're gonna knock off the tiny unicorn antenna above the windshield like I did. Okay, so let's get going and talk driving dynamics.
All right, driving dynamics. This truck weighs about 5,500 pounds.
It's got about 300 horsepower, a little over that in torque, 0 to 60, about 10 seconds. But it doesn't feel slow. In fact, most people comment on how quick it feels. And honestly, as someone who has owned some quick cars, this thing has never left me wanting for more in that category. This is not a car I want to go fast in. It's floaty, the steering is super vague. Like, I know that there's a street underneath me, but I've never felt it through the steering wheel. It's only an idea or a theory. And don't mistake that for comfort. This thing feels like you're driving a tractor. It's both floaty and stiff at the same time. Bumps rock your spine. And braking. Oh, you want to stop? I'm full on the brakes right now. I'm giving it everything I got. This is not a car you stop. You drive this until you run out of gas. That's how you stop. I've been driving this for 5 hours. I'm hungry, I'm tired, and I'm scared. Turning. No, never. Listen, these are built to go over things. You buy them off the lot going a certain direction, just make sure you get the right direction. Mine goes southwest. Okay, let's talk comfort. A lot of people comment on how comfortable this thing must be, and it's really not the case. I do love the seats, and I do love the seating position of this thing, but I'm not in the lap of luxury. You have to remember, this is built on 70s architecture. And it's not quiet, either. Every panel and pane of glass on this is completely flat. The wind cries when I drive this thing. And fun fact about that glass, and I've never heard anyone mention this before, the panes of glass are actually interchangeable. From driver's side to the passenger side, it's the same part number, it's the same piece of glass. That's insane. Every modern car has at least a slight curve in the glass for a number of reasons, but this one doesn't. And what that gives you is a pretty disorienting driving experience at night. Because the windows are completely flat, they actually reflect off of one another, so you might have a car on your right, but it's showing on your left. And this is great if you're a psycho and like to play chicken with yourself, merging on the highway, not 100% sure if a car is really there or not. Let's head home, and I'm gonna talk ownership experience and final thoughts.
So I've had this truck a little over 2 years, and mechanically, it's been a total champ. It's actually been one of the most reliable cars I've ever owned. I'm really keen on the earlier US spec versions of these because they're just simple trucks. Things get exponentially more complicated and expensive as years go on and engines become more powerful. I'm really confident in this truck to get me wherever I need to be and wouldn't be worried about driving it across country should I ever lose my mind and think that spending $20,000 on gas is a good idea. There is a dark side of this truck though, and it's so bad that it's causing me to sell it. And it's not the truck. In fact, 100%, if you're a car enthusiast, you would fall in love with this thing after you drove it. It's so unique and utilitarian. I've never driven anything like it. It's people's view of it. It gets so much attention, it feels like I'm driving a Ferrari F40 around town. And more often than not, it's bad attention. This is what ruins it, because it's weekly that an event happens that just leaves a bad taste in my mouth. I've had people hanging out windows calling me names. I had people randomly flipping me off. I didn't realize people hated soccer players that much. What it boils down to is this. For people, this truck is a thing. And for me, it's a thing, but it's not that thing. What? Admittedly, for me, I'm a bit very sentimental. Owning cars for me has never been a point A to point B endeavor, which is why I've never really owned a practical car. I have a bent toward quirky, needy cars. They tend to be the interesting ones, the ones with some soul. I think of it kind of like music. You might have a classically trained singer and they can hit every note perfectly, and you know that the music is done right and it's impressive, but something still feels off. Something still feels missing. It feels sterile. And then you have the scrappy singer. They have some rasp in their voice. They might not have the range or precision that the classically trained singer has, but they make up with it with uniqueness and charm. The music feels inspired, not derived or manufactured. And that soul, the unique expression of inspiration. And that's what I search to experience in cars, and that's what I get out of this one. It's got soul. It's got a barn full of soul. It's the king of quirky. It's not what you'd expect. And that's why I love it. But this thing has the strongest stigma of any car I've ever known. I can get past people making assumptions about me. I don't care what people think, but it's the interactions that ruin it for me. It's like owning a really cool home, but you get ding-dong ditched all the time. So what you have here is a car whose reputation precedes it. And it's a real shame because 100%, if you're a car enthusiast, you'd fall in love with this thing. Every single car enthusiast pal made fun of me when I got this. And then after they drove it, they wanted one. Every single one. And it's because it has everything a car enthusiast wants. It's unique, it's fun, it's quirky, and it has a really great story behind it. And unfortunately for me, that's been overshadowed by the idea of the car, which isn't in line with what it is. Or should I say, what it was. The newer ones definitely pander to the hype a bit. But the earlier US spec versions, they're really brilliant trucks. For me, bad interactions aside, it's been a joy to own. Am I gonna sell it? Probably. Will I miss it? Definitely. And that does it for this one. If you enjoyed, like and subscribe. If you didn't enjoy, like and subscribe. What are your thoughts on the G Wagon? Comment below. I love interacting with you all, and I will see you guys on the next one. Bye.